I'm glad to have been invited to this important day in memory of a real friend. So as far as physics is concerned, we are moving from the world where your problem is to collect zillions of events in a few seconds to the world where if you get one event in 1 year, you are very happy. When I was looking at what to say, I discovered and what the relation of Gaspar did everything, of course, in physics and in society, but I discovered that the last paper where his signature appears is an AMS paper from the first flight of the detector. So I immediately spotted also this connection. The question I'm addressing is the fundamental one, what our universe is made of and why had we a chance to be here. I think that both these questions point to the importance of the two sectors of the underground physics that I'm going to talk about, dark matter and neutrino-less double beta decay. Of course, we have understood, there is one way to try to answer the question is smashing particles, and LHC does it very efficiently. The other is probably to be very patient and try to listen to the voice of the universe. Now things are becoming more complex than they were long ago, so now to understand what you're doing, I think you need a compilation of people with different expertise. So that's great that particle physics, astroparticle physics, astrophysics, well, actually astrophysics doesn't exist, astrophysics and cosmology have to get together to try to enlighten what you either you observe or you should plan to observe. It's a kind of intellectual grand unification. I think the contribution of Gaspar, for what I have seen as a member of the Sand Council and at the same time Gaspar was, is, of course, his vision of CERN as an extraordinary successful laboratory that had to be preserved at all costs. And also, discussing with him, I understood that he was very interested in the developments of a sound development of the astroparticle physics sector. So I said I'll talk briefly of two research lines, dark matter and Majorana neutrinos. It could take forever, so I will be short. Dark matter is being searched also at LHC and in space. Assuming that dark matter is composed by particles and assuming that these particles took decision to interact somehow with the normal matter beyond what certainly do gravitational. If they only interact gravitationally, I don't think we will ever spot them. So the best way to look for them is to go underground, safe from all kinds of background, from cosmic rays except neutrinos. Indeed, what is the laser pointer? Okay. Indeed, you have a chance to measure interaction of dark matter with the normal matter until the moment when you start to see, with the sensitivity of your experiment, you start to see the interaction of neutrinos in your detector. At that point, this kind of experiment is over. In this moment, I think that the most successful experiment is Xenon 1-ton, which is now moving to the phase with 5-ton. And eventually, I think that going from Xenon to Argon would be beneficial because it would give the same performances, I guess, but it would cost much less than going to a few hundred, hundred tons or a few hundred tons. As I said, there are two issues here. One is that I think you are intellectually forced to go up to the point where you reach the floor. You started something, you have to finish. This is an experimental law of nature. The second issue is that with this technique, you are exploring this portion of the phase space of what dark matter could be. So you see this is the mass that any kind of dark matter could take. And this is the cross-section that you might expect from any kind of dark matter. So you are really not exploring much of the phase space. So that's the issue. And clearly the experiments I mentioned are optimized for what is called weak interaction massive particles, which are coming from an elegant exploitation of the standard model, essentially, and the cross-sections that are involved in particle physics. Okay, this is another way of looking at the plot of what dark matter could be, and you see that, well, you are here, and somehow here, okay? Axions are also being looked at actively for, although not with the same energy as for money, energy equal money, for the WIMP sector. So my two cents of wisdom is that keep going until you reach the neutrino floor, but at the same time do a serious R&D on something that might allow you to go lower than that if you could exploit the direction of where the particle come from, because of course dark matter comes from everywhere and the neutrinos comes mainly from the sun. So, but also encourage young people to put their effort on non-WIMP dark matter, funding agency to provide them with money, and also to ensure them, if they follow that path, they will have a reasonable career. Otherwise, nobody will start something that might not publish anything forever. The other sector, and of course, dark matter is important because it apparently is 25% of the universe as we know it. The other question has to do with the neutrino-less double beta decay. As we know, I personally know, having looked for it, measuring precisely the Khabibov-Kobayashi-Maskawa angles, including the CP violation, didn't enlighten us about the asymmetry or matter-antimatter asymmetry. It didn't add much. Now, it's very strange because you have something that is one of the components of the elements that you need for the solution of that puzzle, but you are orders of magnitude away from what you would need. Of course, you can hope that having the same story on the lepton sector, you might have a solution to your problem. So neutrino-less double beta decay is an interesting process where a nucleus is not energetically allowed to make the transition of a single beta decay, but it wants to decay, so it has to go on to a double step. Now, this double step has a little issue associated with it, that you have to have two decays essentially at the same time in the same place inside the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, and an additional and this exists because the neutrino is double beta decay with the emission of two electrons and two neutrinos, which is common, okay, 10 to 17, 10 to 20 years, I mean, nothing important. But here you have an additional complication that the neutrino emitted from one of the neutron should be reabsorbed by another neutron, so the two neutrinos disappear and only two electrons are left in the final state. The interest for what the universe is made of, it's in the fact that how these neutrinos in this case would acquire mass. They could acquire mass through the Majorana mechanism to the fact that neutrino is the same particle, only the two spin state projected on the axis of flight would say if it is a neutrino, or what we call neutrino and antineutrino, but it's indeed the same particle. And the fact that they have a very low mass, instead of adding to standard model the Dirac component of a neutrino right, which give mass in the same way as it does to other leptons, you could have a right-handed neutrino very massive, which allows this mechanism that has been elegantly pictured as the CISO mechanism. What it adds to our knowledge is that the fact that the neutrinos already violate lepton number in terms of electron mu and tau is known, but globally that is not something that you have in standard model. The standard model also is supposed to conserve B minus L, and in this case B minus L would be violated. This is a gate to the new physics, which is particularly important. So I'm proud to say that, to my mind, the best experiments on neutrinoless double beta decay are done at Gran Sasso Laboratory, and especially the Gerda experiment is a real jewel. If you look at this plot, it's the most recent result from Gerda. This number, okay, this is the plot of the counting row and after all the selection. So if you look in the double beta region, the enlarged picture, inset the picture, you see that essentially this corresponded to a level of background of 5.6 10 to minus 4 counts per kilo electron volt of resolution, per kilogram of mass, and per year of counting time. Now, this is particularly important. This now, if you multiply by the resolution, by the mass, and by the time they have run, this corresponds essentially in 0.1 event of background in the region of interest for the double beta decay. Now, why this is important? This is important because the name of the game is in this formula, which contains a square root, and the square root is the mass of your detector, the time you are running, the inverse of the background index, and the inverse of the energy resolution. Now, if you go with background, okay, you only gain with the square root. So if you want to gain an order of magnitude of 10, you have to run 100 times something more 100 times more mass, 100 times more time, 100 times less energy resolution. I mean, something that it's essentially tells you that you will not do, okay? So essentially the only thing is that you have to run at background equals zero. Okay, zero doesn't exist, but zero means that you can run until you have, say, one event of background, okay? At that point, you have to invent something different. Now, as Gerda has achieved a 10 to 26 year lifetime with a background of 0.1, you are confident that you can get to 10 to 27. You can get 10 to 27, increasing the mass by a factor, what they are doing, about a factor 4 at this point, and running two times more time, or some equivalent things, okay? 10 to 27 is achievable. Now, what's the problem? That if you can want to get 10 to 28, you have got a problem, because you cannot increase the mass by factor 10, because you are already in the order of a couple of tons at that point. And so you mean that you have to have to enrich an isotope, a solid isotope, at a level of a couple of tons. A level of a couple of tons means a couple of hundred millions of something. But this is not the issue. If you want to enrich one ton of something, it could take forever for the capacity of the factory that spin the centrifuge for anything which is not military, okay? Because those exist, but you don't want to make an experiment with enriched uranium. So I think that if you don't see anything at the level of 10 to 27, you have carefully planned your next step at 10 to 28. There is an easy solution which is advertised by many, which is Xenon. However, even enriching Xenon is costly, much less costly, a factor 10 less costly than any other thing. However, the point of having dozens of tons of Xenon is a production, industrial production issue. I mean, the global Xenon production in the world doesn't exceed probably 20 tons per year, and I guess that's used for something. Okay, so let me finish thanking again the memory of Gaspard, because I think we should always keep in mind the way he has gone through his life with intelligence, passion, and artwork. And at the same time, having time not only for physics, but for enriching the civil society. I guess that Portugal is proud of him, and I think the rest of Europe should be also proud of him. Okay, thank you very much.